was raised over on the north side of town in a place called Tarrant City, and commuted over here to Sanford every day and back, and graduated in 1967. And so I've been on this campus for a long time, back and forth. And as Scott outlined, I have pastored, I have been a missionary, I have pastored again, and now we have been carrying people from Alabama, Georgia, Tennessee, South Carolina, Florida, first team next year from Mississippi, and we do the shotgun approach in the country of Guatemala. We take people to the furthest reaches we can in Guatemala, to the urban areas, all over the country. But with each church, it's a rifle approach, because we do church-to-church partnerships. Find a church in Guatemala for a church here to partner with, and we do our ministry in that way. So 52 years of study. I was in ministry already. I was a student pastor when I was here. 18 years on the mission field, Costa Rica, Panama, and Guatemala. And then these last 10 years of retirement. And so that's kind of my background. What I'd really like to do today is just kind of get a conversation started by sharing five reflections that are very personal. They, in a lot of ways, are provincial. The part of the world that I know is Latin America. And, of course, the world is a lot bigger than that. I was looking at the video screen out there of the alumni of Beeson that is somewhere in the world today. And that is such an incredible thing, just to stand there and watch those people's faces and names flow by and recognize where God is sending people forth. To where, from here, and it's a very humbling thing to look at their lives and to pray for them briefly as they pass by. So the first thing I wanted to put on the table is the primacy of the local church in missions. And these are reflections that I hope that you will reframe for your generation and the next generation to come. But these are things that I think are lasting that need to be reflected upon. Of course, in the book of Acts, the first mention of the church, I think, is in chapter 5. And then there are repeated references to the church. Chapter 11, the church at Jerusalem, Paul and Barnabas at the church in Antioch, I started to say Antioquia. And they were there for a year. They went out on a mission trip, preaching and evangelism. Chapter 14, they come back. After they had evangelized, it says they went back through Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch. And they were doing two things. They were strengthening the disciples, and they were naming leaders for the churches. And that gives us an insight into the methodology of the Apostle Paul, which was primarily a local church. Local churches had been established in all these places where they had gone. It doesn't tell us that up until that point, but then it says now they're establishing leaders for those churches. And so the local church, Paul in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 5 says, "I thank God for my fellowship in the gospel with you." The Holman Christian Standard Bible translates that word fellowship, partnership. I love that word. Fellowship, participation, partnership, koinonia. And so that's kind of given me my working definition of missions. Again, it fits where I am in the world and what I know. Missions is global gospel activity that results in gathered believers who engage in global gospel activity that result, and I've got three dots after that definition. I kind of think that although it's correct to put a period at the end of a complete sentence in English, even about a missions definition that may be biblically, it's not correct to put a period at the end of your missions definition. Because it's a process that goes on and on. And so I summarize the Apostle Paul's ministry as going out from churches that were born out of the gospel to start churches themselves born out of the gospel, strengthen them and connect them. Just stop and think about the going back and forth, and whether it be personally or through correspondence of Paul between Jerusalem and Antioch and Ephesus and Macedonia and Rome. And that interconnectivity just goes in all kinds of different directions. And so my question is this, and this is where we'll probably get some discussion later. My question is this: in our international activities, if we are not a part of a gospel-based process of starting a church or strengthening a church or partnering with a church and other gospel activity, is what we do international missions or merely international ministry? I think sometimes here in the States, anything we do off campus, we kind of lump into that missions category. I wonder if we should be more intentional than that. And so that's my reflection on that. I sure am looking forward to hearing you respond to that. Second reflection has to do with the power of personal presence in missions. And so I take people on mission trips, and I try to get people personally present in our part of the world. There are estimates that maybe 2 million short-termers go out from the United States every year. Probably a couple of, I don't know how many billions of dollars are spent on mission trips just from the United States alone, but it's a multi-billion dollar enterprise on short-term missions. I remember when I heard of my first mission trip in 1975. Shades Mountain Baptist Church went to Antigua in the Caribbean. That's the first one I'd ever heard of. I was a young pastor over in LaGrange, Georgia. And they went on that mission trip. Later on, I was a young missionary. And as a young missionary, I had my first volunteer mission team in about 1980. And it was a group of university students from Ivy League schools up in the Northeast from through the BCM came to Panama and spent a week with me assisting us in our ministry. I was an administrator for the IMB in 7 countries of Central America for 8 years. And so we went through the avalanche of volunteers that started to come to Central America and to the Caribbean. Bold mission for us was a thing back then. It's an old theme of something that Southern Baptists did a long time ago. And one of the goals that we had set was to have 10,000 volunteers go from Southern Baptist churches. And I think we had 10 years to accomplish that. We accomplished that in Central America and the Caribbean in about 5 years. When it started, it just went. And we were overwhelmed. Missionaries pretty well thought that volunteers coming, they started out, the vast majority of them thought, this is a terrible interruption to what we're trying to get done down here. And then others felt that it was actually a threat to what we were trying to get done down there. And then we kind of moved to, well, you know, it could be a pretty good recruiting tool to get other missionaries to come, because in my day, all the missionaries were recruited in what we call GAs and RAs. They still have that in any Baptist churches that are anything. There were Girls Auxiliary and Royal Ambassadors, and it was the missions organization for boys and girls in Baptist churches back then. And so it taught us missions. And almost all of the missionaries that came prior to 1980 came because of that influence. At that point, people started coming because they had been on the field and they had seen it for themselves and they wanted to come back. The first mission trip I ever went on, I got on a plane with our family and we had 19 pieces of luggage all together, what we carried on and what we checked in, and we went to live for 3 years. That was my first mission trip. I'd never done anything like that before. And that was the pattern before that point. But then after that was kind of the watershed year. And then after that, people started coming as volunteers. And then it kept, in our part of the world, it became, and is like for me now, it almost like an alternative mission strategy. I mean, there is a way to utilize volunteers to accomplish a lot of really good things in missions. Now, even having said that, 10 years ago, Helping Without Hurting came out. We happen to have a young man in our church who's now a missionary in Indonesia who brought that to me as his pastor and said, I want you to take a look at this. He was a student at Covenant, where the professors were. And he majored in microeconomics, and he applies that on the mission field. And so it was pretty interesting. Basically, I don't want to be unfair because there's a lot more to it than that. But the one thing you for sure get out of it is that even if well-intentioned, short-term missions, by and large, does a great deal of harm. Rather than helping. And so ever since that point, there's been calls for churches to counsel mission trips, please to send matching money to community development or local ministries that match the money that you spend getting there and doing things, demands to take the self-importance out of mission trips by rebranding them as vision trips, listening trips, learning trips, and so forth and so on, and even suggestions that our purpose in traveling as Christians should be to transform ourselves into good advocates for the things that we discover, whether it's eradicating poverty or even immigration reform. And so, you know, it has swung back and forth in my lifetime, from traditional mission trips all the way out. And so perhaps we're having conversations now about, well, what is the missiological quality of the trip? How can we have the trip without causing harm? How can we make it contribute in basically a positive way? But there are still questions. I've had people just say it to me. I've had Baptist missionaries, and I have had lay people. I have had pastors say to me, well, wouldn't it be better just to take that $20,000, that $30,000 that it takes for 20 people to go to the mission field and just give that to a mission cause? You can do that. But if we're not careful, I think we may have swung back to the point of where we were. If we're asking ourselves a question, would it be better to give your dollars and let professional missionaries and local ministries and professionals, social work professionals, do the work in the right way? Just give them the money. If I'm not mistaken, Baptists, British and American Baptists, tried that. From 1793 until 1980, we've already tried that, and so it's just another form of an older traditional way of letting the professionals do it. To my way of thinking. Although there is something to be learned from that conversation for people that go on mission trips and for people that do short-term missions. And so I think the case can be made for every believer to personally engage in international discipleship in a way that empowers the disciple to do the same. Jesus came on a mission trip. That's what the incarnation is all about. Jesus sent the 12 out on short-term missions. He sent the 72 out on short-term missions. It was the precursor of all the missions activity of the apostles and the ones that they won that did missions activity. And so I personally think that it's really good for us to ask ourselves the question, to what degree am I personally a witness to the nations? Obviously, everybody cannot personally go. For someone to be sent, somebody has to send. We understand that. All of us can pray. Any missionary that's ever spoken to your church has said that to you. But to what degree and how am I personally a witness to the nations, whether it's in the international community in Birmingham, a mission trip to Guatemala, a mission to Central Asia? I don't know what that means for anybody in this room, but it should mean something. And here's my most, I think this is kind of radical. Spend your money on a mission trip. Go and get your hands dirty, rub shoulders, go in homes, go in schools, serve, listen, open your mouth, share the gospel, and come home. And if you want to spend money instead of going on a mission, instead of going on a trip, sacrifice your dream American vacation that everybody deserves. And take that money and send it to missions. And then with what's left over, you can go on another mission trip. And so, I don't know. Sometimes my reflections as an old retired pastor turn into rants. Now my third thing I want to get on the table with you guys is the idea of a process-based missions journey for believers. It says repeatedly in the book of Acts that they were disciples. They belonged to the way. They were part of a pilgrimage. They were part of a journey. The Christian movement was known as a journey, as a way. That metaphor or that tag tells us something about who we're supposed to be. In my way of thinking, short-term missions, volunteer missions, is not about going on mission trips. But it is about simple obedience to the Great Commission, humble service to those for whom Jesus died. It's about the opportunity to take another step in a process in my life and to encourage someone else, somewhere else, to take another step in that process in their life, the life of being a disciple, of being a learner, being a follower, being on the way. I think that that our task is not to determine what place missions has in my life, but rather to discover where my life is in the mission of God. And so we can keep that perspective of a process-based journey as far as the mission of God. I think that helps our missiology. Number four, and the idea is that of a platform of servanthood for effective missions. 2 Corinthians 4:5 says, we preach not ourselves, but Jesus Christ is Lord, and ourselves, your servants, as Christ, for Christ's sake, or for his sake. And that's the Apostle Paul's platform. That's his position, who he was in relationship to the people that he related to in the enterprise of missions. I love that bracelet, E3 Partners, is a missions organization that has a lot of, anybody know of them here in Birmingham? Yeah, some of you probably go with them. They have this this little rubber band, and they have t-shirts and hats, and I have some of them. Our organization is E3 Volunteers, and we're just me and my computer. But, you know, they're a big worldwide organization. And but I have some of their stuff and wear it, and it says, I am second. Any of y'all have one of those? I am second. And it's that idea of where we are in relationship to others and in relationship to Christ. I believe that you will have an effective mission, no matter how long you might be on the mission field, if you look for ways to serve the Lord. Serve your fellow team members, serve your host Christian brothers and sisters, serve anyone that God puts in your path. When we were in Costa Rica in language school, Kathy's grandma came to see us, and along with her parents. And so she was from up in Cordova, Alabama. And so she walked in our house there, our apartment there in Costa Rica. And back in those years, a lot of missionaries had someone to cook for them because we were in language school all morning. And then we ate lunch and then we took back out on cultural assignments in the afternoon. And so she came in and Doña Saneda was our cook. And so Kathy's grandmama, Mimi, walked in the kitchen and she puts her back down, she walks in the kitchen and she says, can I help you? And Doña Saneda said something back to her. And then she said something back to her. All this in English and in Spanish. And they got along grandly for a whole week. And they didn't understand it because they were just helping each other. My grandmother called it hoping. Anybody ever heard that from a real? I think it's in one of the old King James Version Bibles that way. So this just raises the reflection to me. How many cultural and language mistakes can you make if you're a servant? How can you come across as the great white hope if you really see yourself as a learner and a servant? Even though, as John the Baptist, we want to be strong in spirit and see great things happen, if we are always saying, I must decrease and he must increase, can we not be effective? Even if it's just for 8 days. Well, the place of students and missions, I don't know how my time is coming, but I need to hurry here, I know that. The place of students and missions, I want to say a word about that. I think it starts with the apostle and missionary Paul choosing John Mark and Timothy and Titus and Silas, Barnabas sticking and developing John Mark to the point that Paul wanted him back on his missionary team. I'm pretty sure we owe the Gospel of Mark to Barnabas for his rescue of a young missionary volunteer after his first failed mission trip. Jesus choosing and discipling the young John and 9 other followers besides Peter and Matthew, who the rest of them were, by the best we can tell, unmarried and probably 21 years of age or younger. And then turning them loose on the world. I think there's the Old Testament, it is replete with all kinds of examples of how God used millennials and younger. And so I have come to the conclusion from my own life that these are not just sermon illustrations and Bible stories. I think they tell us something about God's kingdom and gospel strategy. Just stop and think about a modern missions movement. 1886, Dwight L. Moody had a student conference, and out of that, they started having meetings about missions within that. The first one of those 21 people showed up. A.W. Pearson, who was a well-known preacher of that generation, spoke. And then the students chose 10 students from different places. 3 of them were North American, and seven of them were from every other from other countries, and then all of them spoke and they prayed for these other countries. And as a result of all of that, God's Spirit came down, and 100 students made commitments to become what they called at that point foreign missionaries. And what is called the student volunteer movement was launched with that. But it started a lot earlier. In 1806, five university students from up in New England had what is called a haystack prayer meeting. They were driven in from a rainstorm, and they got up under a haystack. And they were out in the field, and they were discussing missions. And they had that meeting, and out of that meeting grew 6 years later the sending of Adoniram and Ann Judson Luther Rice to India to join William Carey. And so that was, you know, William Carey, 1792. Earlier than that, was a young man, a young pastor when God sent him. 1729, John and Charles Wesley started the Holy Club at Oxford, and George Whitfield joined later. The Wesleys came to Georgia one time on a mission trip for 9 months, and George Whitfield came back and forth across the Atlantic 7 times in his life and died on the mission field in North America. And so all of that happened among young people. I'll just say to you, the first interview that I had as a missionary when I arrived to Panama by Foreign Mission Board, IMB executive, Don Kammerdinger, came and visited with us. And so I asked him, I said, if you were at the point where we are, freshly graduated from language school, what would you do again that you did, or what would you not do that you did? Just tell me what to do. And he said, he gave me 3 or 4 things, but I only remember one of them. And that one was, always have some young people that you are investing in. Whatever your assignment as a missionary, always have some young people that you are investing in. And so I tried to do that as a missionary, as a young, in that first term, living in out in David, Panama, which hot, 7 hours from Panama City. There's no other North Americans around anywhere. And it was so hot that they called it the sucursal del infierno. And what that means is a branch office of hell. It was really a hot place. It was just so happened that in the town where we were, they already had a church, and it was full of young people. It was full of young people. They just had a little handful of children and a little handful of adults, and we probably had 25 or 30 young people. And so we took those young people and we went to a neighboring town 20 minutes away called Concepción de Chiriquí, and we started the church there with those young people. They did it. And so we transferred, and I was doing student ministry at University of Panama for 6 years. And during those 6 years, utilizing university students and seminary students, we were able to start 11 churches in 6 years, and 10 of them survived and are still churches today. And so you don't have to convince me about the value of students and the impact that students can have on international kingdom work. Not at all. In our organization now, a lot of the opportunities that we have are greatly weighed toward millennials and students in particular. We have the 1 week opportunities, and the youngest I've ever had come on that was 6 months old. She hung on her mama's neck on the front side for a whole week. The oldest I've ever had is 83 years, 82, George from Liberty Park. I think he was 82 when he came to Guatemala, worked all week long, never let up a bit. Those are the 1 week opportunities, and we've had every year, I think we got 6 student teams coming next year out of the probably 70 teams that we'll have. There'll be 6 that are just student teams. And then there'll be students on almost every team that comes. We have a 1 month opportunity for summer missions. We have a 40-day opportunity for radical missions in a village where there's next summer, in which there is no evangelical church of any kind in a very remote area of Guatemala. We have 3 to 4 month semester opportunities, and then we have 1 year and beyond right now. And I thought they were going to call me, and they haven't called me. We have a national missionary, Guatemala national missionary, who his name is Kevin Cruz. He was one that was going to call. There's 2 other national Guatemala missionaries that have come on board with our organization. And then John Michael Williams just moved to Guatemala on Monday and is just getting started in his ministry there. He's a senior at Oregon State University, and he's from Tennessee, but he's spending his last year in college working online and already getting his missionary career started. And so